Hello, I am Stephen Farou, and I want to tell some stories about the stuff that database developers' nightmares are made of. And I'll talk first about vanishing rows. When you run a simple select star over the table, you see the data, you would expect it to be returned by your query, and it's not there. Some of the mistakes are beginner's mistakes, but I have also seen experienced developers being caught. For my examples, I will use a small table of movies, but I also have a table of persons and a table called credits that links movies to persons. In credits, the role is indicated by one letter, A for actor, D for director. If I query my movies table, I get a list of 17 movies from 1920 to 1993 from different countries, GE for Germany, the US, the UK, France, and Sweden. The typical beginner's mistake is to say, I want to see all of the movies from the US and all of the movies from Germany. Result? Nothing. The mistake is the AND, because the condition actually means the condition country is US is true, and the condition country is DE is true, which no rows can match. We should use OR instead, or the equivalent and perhaps more legible IN condition. It is easy for a newbie to be caught by conditions, especially as we are often a bit lax about them in real life. For instance, although I would definitely not advise to try to argue with an officer, this Singapore sign might suggest that eating is okay as long as you don't drink at the same time. In Hong Kong, they have it right from an IT viewpoint. But even experienced developers may make mistakes when conditions become complicated. And you must, for instance, master the laws of De Morgan that state that not condition 1 or not condition 2 is logically equivalent to not condition 1 and condition 2, but that not condition 1 or condition 2 is equivalent to not condition 1 and not condition 2. Sometimes we find that one way to express a condition is much easier to understand than another, but conversions often lead to mistakes and disappearing rows. Conditions in an SQL statement are mostly a question of logic. But it's logic with a particular twist. In the world of logic, things are either black or white, true or false. But in a database, you may have unknown values and conditions that can't be decided. Very often, nulls are the cause for disappearing rows, and I'm going to give you two examples, a relatively simple one and something that can take you off guard even if you know SQL well. First, the data in my movies table. Just try to remember that we have 17 rows, that the oldest movie is The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, and the most recent one, The Nightmare Before Christmas. I am going to display the name of the director next to the movie title and the year, using the credits table to relate a movie to a person who has the D role for this movie. And oops, I have 19 rows. You might think that I have magically made two rows appear and that nothing has disappeared, but in fact, the 1945 movie Dead of Night was what was called a portmanteau movie with several directors. In fact, The Nightmare Before Christmas has disappeared. Why? Actually, it's a very simple reason. I haven't entered the name of its director, Henry Selick. There is no matching row in table credits, and the movie vanishes. To correct my query, I must first use a function to have a list of directors when I have several ones, array ag with Postgres, group concat with MySQL, list tag with Oracle, and use two left outer joins, one to say that I want null values from credits if I find no matching movie, and one to say that I want an empty value from persons if there is no match in credits. Then I get the proper number of rows, the movie for which the director is unknown is present, and I have a single row for Dead of Night. But let's now see something more subtle. My persons table looks like this, with an identifier, a first name and a surname, and optionally a year of birth and a year of death. Here is the list of all the different birth years I have in my table. I'm cheating a little bit with the layout so that you can see all of them. And let's say that I want to see the movies that were released any year except one of these. What am I expecting? If I get my list of movies and compare it to the years of birth that more or less cover the same interval, I see that some people were born in 1931, for which I have two movies, in 1933, for which I have two movies again, and in 1945, for which I have Dead of Night. There is no other match, and therefore I expect to see those 12 movies. If I write this query, I'll get no rows with any DBMS product. The only SQL engine I know that will return the expected result is SQLite. What is going on? I can tell you. The culprit is this gentleman, who played in the cabinet of Dr. Caligari, and for whom I have found no information on Wikipedia. He is the only one in my table with an unknown year of birth. What happens when the SQL engine tries to evaluate the condition for 1920, the year when the cabinet of Dr. Caligari was released? It is compared to all known birth years, and there is no match. Then comes this dreaded unknown year of birth. Is 1920 equal to it or not? There is no way to tell. And in doubt, we abstain and don't return the row. Of course, it's the same logic with all rows, and in the end, no rows are returned. If you want to see the expected result, it's very simple. Just add a condition that says that you don't want unknown values. Another common beginner mistake, but which will take us much farther than the beginner level, is when you search with the wrong case. In my table, the words of a title are capitalized. In an SQL statement, you have different things. You have keywords, words that have a special meaning in the language, and aren't case sensitive. Identifiers, the name you give to tables, views, columns, are not usually case sensitive. Actually, MySQL is case sensitive for table names, but not for column names. But the data is always case sensitive, and when you compare the contents of a row to a constant, it must exactly match. There is only one solution, to standardize. Trim spaces, fold everything to the same case, and if you think that you cannot improve the way the data looks when you retrieve it, store standardized values that you can search alongside non-standardized values that you display. There is some data, though, for which you don't usually have an exact match, datetime values. Here you must very often compare intervals. I have devoted a video to several issues you can have with dates in SQL. Watch it if you want to learn more. Standardization of data is also something that is used by the DBMS for internal needs, and I am going to discuss a little more the case sensitiveness of identifiers. If you enclose table or column names between double quotes with Postgres or Oracle, then it becomes case sensitive. And as Postgres folds everything to lowercase, Oracle folds everything to uppercase, you must exactly match what is stored in the data dictionary if you want the DBMS to correctly identify the table when you enclose the name. I have standardized my titles, capitalizing all important words, yet I search for one movie that is in my table, I don't find it. Once again, I have no exact match. In my table, there is a dot both after Dr. and Mr. It means that when my columns don't contain very simple data, it's very difficult to get an exact match. For titles, whether they are of movies, songs or books, for short descriptions of articles, for post subjects, searches will be difficult. There are tons of possibilities for approximate searches. You can use the like operator that allows you to search for a pattern, but it's not convenient at all if the users enter a title that is assumed to be correct. You can use regular expressions that are more powerful than like, but it's the same problem. Writing a regular expression isn't always easy. Transforming user input into a regular expression? Forget about it. And finally, there are tags, which is the approach used by full text indexing. Full text indexing is not something that is quite standard. Most, but not all products have it, and the syntax varies. I am using here Postgres, and if I use the double at operator, I will run a full text search. You see here that I haven't the dots, I have the case wrong, and yet Postgres finds the movie. How does it work? When Postgres sees the double at operator, it transforms both the column value and the constant or parameter that is compared to it. It first removes everything that isn't a word, standard IDs are the case, and turns the full title into a list of tokens. Actually, it's even more sophisticated, but I don't want to get into details. My constant is also transformed into a list of tokens, and the condition becomes that we want to find all of these tokens. But there are several issues. The first one is that if the user misspells one of the words, the simple syntax I have used no longer works. I could express the condition so as to get the closest match, but then I have to process the user input and generate a special full text search query that isn't that simple. More worrying is that full text indexing isn't always available. It works out of the box with Postgres and with SQL Server. With Oracle, you must ask to a DBA to activate it. But in all cases, full text indexing has a complexity directly related to its power. With MySQL, it's more complicated. If you want full text indexing, you must use the MyExam storage engine. But if you want foreign keys and referential integrity, as well as rule locking, you must use the InnoDB storage engine. I tend to find foreign keys more important than full text indexing, but both may be desirable and the choice may be difficult. It's however relatively easy to set up a simple full text indexing of one's own, which is not suitable for indexing documents, but works well for titles or subjects. I am going to create a table called tags, in which I am going to store, possibly for different tables and columns, the tags that I am going to search and relate to one particular key. I decide, which is debatable but more convenient for key definition, that even if a word occurs several times in a title, I record it only once. You may decide to do otherwise. I am going to use PHP as a relatively neutral language, but of course you could use any language, triggers, whatever. First, a list of single characters that I want to remove from the text. I am not sure that I am exhaustive, but you can easily modify it. Then I create a second array with as many single spaces as I have characters in the first array. I can now write a function that I call tagify that takes as parameters the string that I want to break into tags, then the two arrays I have just created. The first operation consists in replacing in the string all the characters I want to remove by spaces. While I am at it, I fold everything to lowercase. This may create several spaces in succession, and I replace with a regular expression any consecutive spaces by a single space. If I were processing a language with accentuated letters or special characters, I might want to replace them too, for instance in German, replace SZ by a double S and so on. What I return will be the trimmed process string that I am going to split on the spaces into an array with one triple word, and I remove duplicates to suit my primary key requirement before I return it. Alright, now I can open a try block, connect to the database, and I'm going to massively process the existing data. Normally, I should do it every time I insert or update. I am going to loop on my titles, transform each one of them into an array of tags, and then insert each tag associated to the ID. This would strongly penalize operations on transactional database with a lot of inserts. But if I mostly use my database for searches, it can be fine. I end my connection, finish the try block, and I am done. Errors are the type of data I get in my tax table. It's a very rough sketch. Perhaps I should have removed single letter tags, or very common words that I'll find everywhere. Full text indexing systems do that. You can easily improve on what I'm showing here, but you see the idea. What is interesting is how I am going to use these tags to execute a kind of fuzzy search by using nothing but strict equality. Let's go back to PHP and say that I am looking for a misspelled Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I am going to apply the tagify function to the string I am looking for. Next, I recombined the sanitized tags into a comma-separated list of quoted words. For the record, I could also pass them as parameters, which would be better SQL programming, but never mind. I connect to the database, and the interesting part is my query. I am going to get the identifiers of all of the movies in which title I find at least one of the tags that I am looking for. For instance, the DR tag will match both Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde and The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. And to find the best match, I am going to count how many tags match per movie, sort by this score, and just return the movie with the best score. I'll let you think about ties. Once I have the identifier of the movie, the title of which best matches my search string, I join with the movies table, and possibly other tables, to return the information I am interested in. This is what it gives when I display the title of the movie I have found. To summarize, if you understand well logic, if you understand well nulls, and if you understand well that when you search in the database you must always have strict equality, there is no reason to see rows vanish, and there is no reason for overtells.